हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स। एज वी आर स्टडिंग चैप्टर 9, दैट इज सॉइल। सो दिस इज़ द सेकेंड पार्ट ऑफ दिस चैप्टर। इन दिस पार्ट वी विल स्टडी अबाउट प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ सॉइल, इन विच वी विल स्टडी अबाउट एब्जॉर्प्शन ऑफ वाटर बाई सॉइल, मॉइस्चर इन सॉइल एंड परकोलेशन रेट ऑफ वाटर इन द सॉइल। देन वी विल स्टडी अबाउट काइंड ऑफ सॉइल, effects of climate on soil, importance of soil, soil pollution, soil erosion, and at last we will study the prevention and effects of soil erosion. So students, before starting this part, I just want to remind you that in the last video, or means first part of this chapter, we have studied about soil formation of soil, means we have studied about weathering and different agents of weathering. Then we have studied about humus, then soil profile, and we have studied about composition of soil, means what are the things which from which soil is made up of. And at last we have studied about types of soil, in which we have studied about sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil. So this types of soil, means sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil, these three types are very important, because the properties which we will study in this part, we will study the properties of these three types of soil. So again, I just want to recall you about the some of the properties of these three types of soil. As we have studied about sandy soil, that in sandy soil large size particles are present. In clay soil we have studied that in clay soil small sized particles are present, and loamy soil is the mixture of clay, sand and silt. And we have studied that the spaces between the sandy soil, that spaces are quite large, and it is very porous also. Then in clay soil we have studied that the spaces between the particles are very less, and sufficient spaces are present in between the particles of loamy soil. Then we have studied that sandy soil is well aerated, while clay soil is not well aerated, and loamy soil also can hold sufficient air. Then sandy soil is not having water holding capacity is very poor, means it cannot hold water. In clay soil we have studied that its water holding capacity and nutrient holding capacity is very good, and loamy soil has sufficient air holding as well as water holding capacity, and it can hold the right amount or appropriate amount of nutrients also. That is why loamy soil is the best soil for crop cultivation. So now in this part we will start with properties of soil. So different soil has different properties, and so many types of properties are there. As three properties you can see here: absorption of water by soil, moisture in the soil and percolation of rate of water. So we will study about these things. Before this we will discuss some other properties also. So first we will discuss the texture of soil. Texture means the size of particles of soil. So as we have studied about sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil, so obviously in sandy soil large sized particles are present as compared to clay soil. In clay soil very fine sized particles are present, means its texture is very fine as compared to sandy soil. And in loamy soil both type of particles are present. Sandy means it is the good mixture of sand, silt and clay. So sandy soil, if sand is present, it means large sized particles are present. Clay soil is also present, it means fine sized particles are present. And silt, so silt particles has the size in between the sand and clay, means they are smaller than sand particles and they are bigger than clay particles. So texture means the size of particles which are present in soil. Then one more property is there, that is color. So different soil has different colors, and these colors depends on the minerals and nutrients which are present in soil. As we have studied, we will study about black soil. So black color of the soil is just because of the rich content of humus. Humus is an organic material, and we have studied about humus also. Then suppose we are talking about red soil. So red soil is red, is of red color, and its red color is because of iron oxide. Iron oxide we have studied. Iron oxide is red in color. So if iron oxide is present, it means the soil will be red in color. So the color of the soil depends on the nutrients and minerals which are present in the soil. Now we will start the first property given in this chapter, that is absorption of water by soil. So the absorption of water means every soil absorbs some amount of water, and that water absorption capacity depends on how porous the soil is. Means what is the porosity, what is the spaces present in between the soil particles. So as some plants they grow in soil, so they require, some plants require more water for their growth, whereas some requires less amount of water for their growth. So if the soil has good water holding capacity of water, it means that plants that need the more amount of water, that plants will grow very well in that soil. So different types of soil absorb different percentages of water. Next one is moisture in the soil. So moisture means the amount of water present in the soil. And texture. Texture means the size of the particles. It decides the water holding capacity of the soil. As we know, sandy soil has very less water holding capacity, while clay soil has very good water holding capacity. Then also it is not so good for crops, while loamy soil has the right water holding capacity, and it is very good, it is best for crops. So soil has some amount of water inside it as moisture. So the amount of water which is present in soil, it is called moisture of the soil. Then percolation. Percolation rate of water. So before this, we should know what is percolation. So percolation is the downward movement of water through the soil. Means the water which moves downwards in the soil, we can say seeping of water. So the downward movement of water through the soil is called percolation. Next, we will see what is percolation rate. So before this, I want to give you an example. Suppose you have some water and you are pouring then that water on a cemented floor, and same amount of water you are pouring on the soil surface. So what will happen on the cemented surface, on the cemented floor, the water stays there for some time, and when we will pour some same amount of water on the soil surface, then you will see water will stay there for a very little time, and very soon it get absorbed by the soil. So it shows that that's water absorption is very slow for the cemented floor as compared to the soil. So this is because water can percolate into the soil but not in the cemented floor. So soil percolates rainwater which is collected above bedrock. Means that soil which is which absorbs the water, rainwater, so that water percolates in the soil and it gets collected above the bed rock, and that level of groundwater is called water table, as you have studied in 6th class also, or in 7th class also you will study in water chapter. So what is percolation rate? Percolation, we are knowing that the downward movement of water through the soil. So percolation rate means the speed at which percolation occurs. Means we can say that the amount of water which is percolated in the soil in a given time, so that thing is called percolation rate. So percolation rate we can calculate it by the formula, that is amount of water we will take in ml upon percolation time. Percolation time we will take in minute. So here first we will see one activity is there to determine the percentage of water absorbed by different types of soil. So this is the first property of soil which is given in this chapter, that is absorption of water by soil. So for this property we have an activity in which we have to determine the percentage of water absorbed by different types of soil. So for this activity we need these materials. We need 3 plastic funnels, 3 measuring cylinders. All these things we have seen in our chemistry laboratory. So 3 plastic funnels we need, then 3 measuring cylinder, marker, filter paper, then analytical balance we need. Balance we will need to weigh the amount of soil and water. Then we need water, then we need 50 gram of powdered and dry soil of different types. Different types means sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil. Then we will start it. So first we will take 3 empty measuring cylinders and we will place it on the table. Then we will label them as A, B and C with marker. Then put 1 plastic funnel on each of the measuring cylinder, means at the mouth of measuring cylinder we will put 1 plastic funnel. Then we will take a filter paper, we will fold it properly and we will fix it in each funnel. That thing is also easy to understand because in 6th chapter we have studied about filtration also, and we have studied about filter paper also in the 5th chapter. So next process, when we will fold the filter paper properly and we will fix it in the funnels, then we will place 50 gram sample of sandy soil, loamy soil and clay soil in the funnels which are placed already on the measuring cylinder A, B and C. Then we will leave this, then we will pour 50 ml of water and in each sample of soil, means we will pour water in the funnel in which we have taken sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil. Then we will leave this setup for some time till dropping of water from the funnels stop. Obviously filter paper is there in which soils, different soil samples we have taken, and we have poured some water also, so obviously water will start coming down in the measuring cylinder from funnel. So we will leave the setup for some time and we will wait for that complete dropping of water from the funnel stops. Then we will observe it. Now one more thing, we know the amount of soil we have taken, that is 50 gram. 50 gram of soil we have taken from each sample, that is sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil. And we have taken 50 ml of, suppose we have taken 50 ml of water like this, we can take any amount of water, but for all the 3 soil samples, the amount of water should be same. So suppose we are taking 100 ml, so 100 ml should be for sandy soil, clay soil and loamy soil for all the 3 samples. Now suppose the amount of soil we have taken, that is 50 gram, but suppose the amount of water which we have taken initially we have taken u ml of water means u milliliter water we have taken in the initial stage for each sample, u ml for sandy, u ml for clay soil and u ml for loamy soil. Then suppose as filtrate, after some time we will get water as a filtrate in the measuring cylinder. So suppose we are getting v ml of water as filtrate in the measuring cylinder. So u ml of water we have taken initially and we are getting V ml of water as filtrate. Okay, so what is the amount of water which is absorbed by soil samples? So initially we have taken U ml and as filtrate we are getting V ml. So obviously the amount of water absorbed by soil will be U minus V ml. So if we are, this is the volume of water. If we will convert it into weight, then it will be U minus V gram. So we will calculate the percentage of water absorbed, that is U minus V. U minus V means the amount of water which is absorbed by soil upon 50, because 50 gram of soil sample we have taken. So U minus V upon 50 will be the amount of water absorbed by soil samples, and we have to find out the percentage, then we will multiply it with 100. So percentage of water absorbed is equal to U minus V upon 50 into 100. So by this formula we can find out the percentage of water absorbed by different types of soil. Next activity is there to show the soil contains water. Means we have to show that moisture is present in water. So for this we will take some soil, any type of soil we will take. Then we will take a tin with a lid, then weighing machine for weighing the amount of soil. Then we will take Bunsen burner and tripod stand. Now what we have to do, we will collect some soil and we will put it in a tin. Then we will weigh, first we will weigh the tin and soil together with the weighing machine. Means firstly we will take a tin, we will collect some soil in the tin, we will weigh them, the tin and the soil together with the weighing machine. Then we will cover the tin with its lid and we will heat it with the help of Bunsen burner, and after that we will remove the lid after 5 minutes or some time, and then we will observe it. So we will observe that some small droplets of water are present on the inner surface of the tin as well as on the lid. So this water droplets, we have not added water. So from where this water droplets come? Obviously this water droplets come from the soil. So this shows that the soil contains water. Soil contains moisture. Now next activity is to determine the percolation rate of water in soil. So percolation rate, we are knowing what is percolation rate. So we have to determine the percolation rate of water in soil. So for this we will take one PVC pipe. That PVC pipe should be 20 meter long and 5 centimeter in diameter. Then we will take one measuring cylinder to measure the amount of water, and stopwatch. Then what we will do, we will take a 20 centimeter long PVC pipe with a diameter of 5 centimeter. Then we will select any place, means where soil is present, and we will fix one end of the PVC pipe into the soil up to the depth of 3 to 4 centimeter. Then we will take 200 ml of water in a measuring cylinder. On measuring cylinder, scales are present, so we can measure the amount of water we are taking. So here we will take 200 ml of water in the measuring cylinder, and we will pour this water into the PVC pipe from the top end, means from one of the open end. We'll pour this 200 ml of water in the PVC pipe, then start the stopwatch immediately. As we will pour the water into the PVC pipe, immediately we will start the stopwatch. Now we have to note the time. Now stop the stopwatch when the whole of the water has percolated down the earth. Means we will see from the PVC pipe that there should not be any amount of water left in the PVC pipe. At that time when we will see the complete water, means water is completely percolated in the soil, at that time we will stop the stopwatch. Now we will record some things. As the amount of water, we are knowing that amount of water we have taken, that is 200 ml. We have to note the time, means what is the time, what is the time in minutes taken by the soil to completely absorb the water. Means what is the time taken by the water in this percolation. So now we are knowing the amount of water which we have poured in the soil, and we are knowing the percolation time, means that time should be in minute. Always the amount of water which we will take, it should be in milliliter, and time should be minute, should be in minute. So from here we will calculate the percolation rate. The formula to find out the percolation rate is equal to amount of water. Amount of water means that we are taking in this experiment, and percolation time means what is the time taken by soil to completely percolate the water. Okay, so percolation rate is equal to amount of water upon percolation time. So its unit is ml upon minute. It is the unit of percolation rate. So by this formula we can very easily find out what is the percolation rate of water in soil. Now our next topic is kinds of soil. Kinds of soil means, as we know, there are many types of soil, and some soils they may be very fine, well some others may be very coarse, and the texture of soil, it depends upon the proportion of sand and clay which is present in it. As we know, the sandy soil, they are very coarser grains are present in sandy soil, while in clay soil very finer grains are present. In loamy soil, loamy soil is a mixture of sand, clay and silt. So different types of soils we can find, but now we will see the kinds of soil according to their place where they are found. Means different kinds of soils are found in different regions, and some kinds of soils we are going to study here. So first we will see red soil. Red soil is also known as red latosol, and this red color of the soil is just because of the presence of iron oxide. Iron oxide we have also studied in sixth chapter, where we have studied about rust. In seventh chapter, in sixth chapter we have studied about rust. So at that chapter, in that chapter we have studied that red colored iron oxide is formed on the iron surface, which is called as rust. So iron oxide is always red in color. Here also in that soil, iron oxide is present. That is why the soil is red in color. And except that iron oxide, the soil is very rich in aluminium oxide also. But this soil is very poor in some elements as magnesium, phosphorus and nitrogen. These elements are present in very poor amount. Then the soil is also very poor in humus. Means humus is also very present in very less amount. So this soil is not so good, but some crops can be grown in this soil. If fertilizers are used, means judicial use should be there for fertilizers in that crop, in that condition, crops can be grown in red soil. And in our country, the red soil is found in Kerala, Tamil Nadu, South Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, and in central eastern part. Then next type of soil is black soil. So black soil is also known as black cotton soil or regur. So this soil is mainly, it is derived from basaltic rocks or volcanic rocks. And this soil contains soils of iron, calcium and magnesium. Means they are rich in iron, calcium and magnesium. And the upper layer of this soil contains large proportion of humus and clay also. So if that elements are present, iron, calcium and magnesium, and that one of the most important thing which makes the soil fertile, that is humus is present in large proportion, clay is also present in that soil. So obviously that soil is very good for some crops. So this soil is suitable for growing cotton and sugarcane. And black soil is found in some parts of Maharashtra, Gujarat and Andhra Pradesh. And it is also found in parts of Rajasthan, western part of Madhya Pradesh, South Haryana and in the northwestern part of Uttar Pradesh. Then next type of soil is alluvial soil. So the soil is found along the banks of river. It is carried by rivers over long distances and it get deposited or accumulated on the low-lying plains. This soil contains both sand and clay and the soil is very, very fertile. The soil is rich in humus, except that humus is present. It means the soil is very good, except that some other elements are also present. Then turmeric, sugarcane and paddy grow very well in this alluvial soil. Alluvial soil is found in low-lying areas of Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, West Bengal and the coastal areas of Odisha and Andhra Pradesh. Then next type of soil is laterite soil. So this soil is mainly found in those regions where there are heavy rains. It is very less fertile. And it is suitable for pastures and bushes. But tea, coffee and coconut grow very well in this soil. And laterite soil is found in the Konkan areas of Maharashtra and in parts of Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha and Assam. Next type of soil is desert soil. So desert soil is particulate. It contains plenty of soluble salts, means lots of soluble salts are present. And very good crops can be harvested from desert soil by proper irrigation. Means this, if the soil is properly irrigated, then good crops can be obtained. Then desert soil is found in Rajasthan and in some parts of Gujarat. Next type of soil is mountain or hilly soil. So the constituents of this soil are different in different places, and the amount of humus present in this soil is greater than any other type of soil. Means very good amount of humus is present in mountain and hilly soils. And mountainous soil is mainly found in the Himalayan region. As the name suggests, mountain region. So it is found in Himalayan region and the northeastern parts of India. Next topic is effects of climate on soil. Means how climate affect soil. So climate, we all know climate is the average of all weather condition in an area over a long period of time. That thing we have studied in 7th chapter. So to determine the climate of an area, we have to study the daily weather conditions over many years. As we have studied, weather condition in a region changes from day to day, or some days it rains, and we know some days may be very cold, very warm. So all these things determine the weather. Weather determine the climate, and climate affects the soil of any particular region. Climate affects the flora and fauna also. We have already studied flora means vegetation, fauna means animals. So just like that, climate affects a lot to the soil also. So climate affects both the chemical and biological activities of a soil, including the rate of weathering. Weathering is also affected by climate, because we have studied in the agents of weathering, the rain, flowing water, wind. So all these things come under that situation, that is climate. So we know that higher temperature and humidity, it encourages the chemical decomposition as well as disintegration. And decaying also requires warm and moist conditions. So during winter, these activities slow down or even stop sometime. So therefore, soil in cool and dry climate tend to be shallower than and less developed than those in warm and humid regions. Means warm and humid regions, the formation of soil takes place very fast as compared to that other dry climate, cool and dry climates. So the crops which can be grown in winters cannot be grown in summers, and the crops that can be grown in summers cannot be grown in winters, just because of the climate, and climate affects the soil. Now next one is importance of soil. So soil is the most important natural resource which is available to man. It is considered as a valuable resource because of some of the importance of soil. So first one is, it is an excellent medium in which all plants grow. without soil, we know plants could not have established themselves on land, because soil is needed by plants to for support also. Soil provides the anchorage to the roots of plants, and all plants get minerals and water for from the soil. Means soil acts as a storehouse for mineral and water for all the plants. And a large number of minerals are present. So these minerals are used in a large number of industries also. Then soil is a natural habitat for various organisms such as ants, worms, beetles, centipedes, millipedes, microorganisms. These organisms are also present in soil. So soil acts as their natural habitat. We also know that rat and rabbit, they make burrow in the soil. So soil is very good habitat, natural habitat for these organisms. Then soil is also used as a raw material for making bricks or mortar, pottery, and some other materials. It is also used for making huts and sheds also. Then it is used for the construction of buildings, roads, bridges, industries, and dams, etc. Then rainwater that seeps through the soil and accumulates above the bedrock. So soil acts as a storage tank of water also, and that underground water is pumped out from various for various purposes from so many things. So students, our next topic is soil pollution. As air and water get polluted, soil also get polluted when some harmful substances mixed in soil. So soil pollution is a contamination of soil with harmful substances which have some adversely effect on the quality of soil, which adversely affects the quality of soil and the health of those living organisms which depend on soil. So it directly or indirectly affects the health of all living organisms, or living organisms means plants as well as animals. So we can define the soil pollution as the presence of toxic chemicals. Toxic chemicals means harmful chemicals. They are present in soil, and if they are present in high concentration means they are present in great amount, and then they pose a risk to human health or the ecosystem. Means they are very harmful for human health or for ecosystem. In that case, soil is called as polluted soil, and this is termed as soil pollution. So some of the main reasons for soil pollution. So first of all, we will see wastewater. Wastewater means water which is of no use, which come out from factories or industries. These wastewater, they are very harmful because they consist of harmful chemicals or toxic chemicals. They are having, they contain some acids as sulfuric acid or nitric acid sometime. Because in factories or in industries, these chemicals are used. So if without treatment, this wastewater is disposed of on the soil, so it enters the soil, and this wastewater makes the soil infertile. Then waste molasses from sugar factories, they also flow in field and make the soil infertile. Then percolation of contaminated water into the soil. Suppose contaminated water means water which consists of so many harmful thing. If such type of water get percolated in the soil, then it can pollute the water, which is means it can pollute the underground water, and sometime defecation is also the main reason to pollute the soil. Then excessive use of artificial manure or chemical fertilizers. If there is inefficient use of or excessive use of these fertilizers, are there chemical fertilizers, so they can also pollute the soil and make it infertile. Then insecticides or pesticides, these are the chemicals which are used to kill the pest or insects, and they are used for the protection of food grains or crops. So if they mixed with the soil along with rain or irrigation water, so they can also pollute the soil, and sometimes they used to pollute the water also, because through rainwater they flow with the water. When water gets mixed in the soil, So these insecticides sites or pesticides, they are mixed with water and they move in the water bodies like ponds and other rivers also, and they can pollute the water also. So in that case, they cause water pollution also. Next topic is soil erosion. So soil erosion means the removal of land surface. Land surface means we can say the topsoil. Topsoil means a horizon. We all know that a horizon is rich in humus and in so many mineral elements also. So topsoil is very fertile and very good for the quality of maintaining the quality of soil. So removal of topsoil by the action of strong wind, rain or flood water is called soil erosion. Means the process of carrying away the topsoil by natural forces. Natural forces means water or rain or strong wind. So just because of these natural forces, when the topsoil is carried away, so this is termed as soil erosion. We all know that soil does not remain stationary, means it is not fixed at one point because it is carried away from place to place by the force of nature. Normally also it is carried away from place to place. So the topsoil, being soft and lighter, is carried away more easily. So this damages and removes the fertility of soil, and the delicate balance between the topsoil and subsoil is disturbed. When topsoil is removed, then obviously subsoil is get exposed. So there is a delicate balance between the topsoil and subsoil. It is also disturbed. And we all know that plant roots, they firmly fix the soil. So in the absence of plants, soil becomes loose and it can move by wind or flowing water also. So wind blows away the soil and moving water washes soil away. Normally the soil erosion occurs slowly over a long very long time because trees and grasses hold the soil in place. Because but suppose if there is no any plant or vegetation or grasses are present, so in that case what happened, there is no any soil binder is there because roots used to bind the soil together. So if no plant, no vegetation is there, then roots will not be there. So soil will not bind together, and in that case these natural forces like strong winds or water or rain, they can carry the soil from one place to another place. And one more reason is there, that is human being. It also causes soil erosion in much more quickly than normal. Some of the reasons for soil erosion are there. First one is cutting down of trees. Cutting down of trees means when it is called as deforestation. Deforestation means cutting of trees on a large scale. So when on large scale trees are cut, then what will happen? Their roots will not be there to bind the soil. So in that case also soil is carried away by strong wind, rain or water. Next one is grazing the animals. Grazing the animals means overgrazing. In that case, the animals like goat or sheep, they can graze the grasses and they can eat it by removing out their roots also. So in that case also soil become very loose and soil erosion can happen. Then digging and building on steep slopes, plying the land for crop. Means one more important thing is there, that is slash and burn type of agriculture or zoom cultivation. So people used to move from one place to another place, and they used to clean the forest for cultivation of crops. So this is one more important reason for the soil erosion. Now prevention of soil erosion. So prevention of soil erosion is called conservation of soil. Means when we preserve soil from being eroded, then it is called conservation of soil. The soil erosion can be prevented by the following ways. Some tips are there, some methods are there. So first one is, trees should not be cut down unless absolutely necessary. Means trees should be cut only in that case if absolute necessity is there. Only a few trees should be cut down at one time, and wherever possible, trees should be planted. So one more thing is there, that is afforestation. Afforestation means large scale planting of trees. So if large scale trees should be planted, then it is called afforestation. So afforestation should be promoted. Then trees like bamboo and eucalyptus should be planted, because these trees work as soil binder by not allowing topsoil to run down with the flow of water or by strong wind, and roots of these trees hold the soil firmly together. Then trees should be planted in rows. These trees, when they are planted in rows, they act as windbreakers. So they break the force and speed of a strong wind and prevent it from carrying away the fertile topsoil and help to prevent soil erosion. Then on the slopes of hills, contour farming or terrace farming should be practiced to prevent direct loss of topsoil due to water running down the slopes. Next one is overgrazing by goats and sheep should be prevented. Means more area should be brought under grass or vegetation, and for that grazing animal, suitable pastures and means suitable places should be there, should be developed for these grazing animals. Next one is conservation felling can be used. Means it involves leaving stem and roots of the previous crops in the field. So stem and roots help to hold the soil in place between the time one crop is harvested and another crop is planted. So it is called conservation felling. Then agricultural land should not be left as it is, means uncultivated for a long time, because if no crop will be there and land should be without any type of vegetation, so no soil should be bounded together because the roots will not be there, so it will be eroded. And one more thing, in agricultural fields, there should be special arrangement for proper irrigation and drainage so that the topsoil is not washed away with the flow of water. So these are the methods of prevention of soil erosion. So here your ninth chapter is also completed. Now some understanding based questions are there. First one is, what do you mean by percolation? Then why the sandy soil has poor water holding capacity? What is the reason of red color of red soil? Then what is soil erosion and how it can be prevented? And what is the difference between deforestation and afforestation? So try to find out the answers of these questions from the video and from the chapter. So do watch the video and read your chapters properly and try to find out the answers for the question of objective type questions which are given in your chapter. Okay. Thank you, students.